Hey, how are you?
Good to see you.
Yeah, all right.
Sorry.
You too.
Good to watch.
Good evening. Thank you for sticking around for the second portion of our 2018 debate series. The next debate is the congressional debate for Georgia District 7, Rob Woodall and Shane Hazel. To this debate, would somebody close those doors? Justin, close those doors. Justin, you got it? Thank you. This portion of the debate will be moderated by Julianne Thompson. Julianne's come over from Gwinnett County to assist us this evening. She's a former legislative aide in the U.S. House of Representatives and a former communications director for the Georgia Republican Party. She's a political contributor for BBC World News. She's a regular panelist on the Georgia Public Broadcasting's Political Rewind. She served as a surrogate for President Donald Trump during the 2016 general election and is a state and executive committee member of the Georgia Republican Party. Julianne is married to Jason Thompson. They have two children, and they come over and visit us from Sewanee. Julianne, thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Justin will determine the order in which the questions will be asked. Congressman Woodall will take the first question.
Good evening. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. I'd like to go over a few basic rules before we start this debate. I'm sure that none of these general housekeeping rules would apply to either one of these candidates, but I'm going to say them anyway. No sending or receiving any text messages during the debate. Each candidate will conduct themselves in a diplomatic manner. Disruptive behavior and crude language is not acceptable, which we know is not going to happen, but we're going to say it anyway. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to introduce himself and discuss the issues that are important to his campaign. There will be a general question session for the first part, where each candidate will be asked the same question in alternating order. The answers will be 1 minute. If applicable, a rebuttal of 30 seconds will be allowed. We have a lot of material to cover tonight, so rebuttals will be at my discretion. Specific candidate questions will follow the general questions, and each candidate will be allowed to ask the other candidate a question of their choice. Following that, there will be a 1.5 minute closing from each candidate. And with that, we will get started. And who drew the first question? Okay. Congressman Woodall. Recent public shootings have opened back up the debate on gun control. What measures from the federal government, if any, do you support to improve school safety And how do you balance this with protecting Second Amendment rights?
Excuse me, hold on just a minute, Congressman. They need to make their opening statement.
Oh, I am so sorry. That is my fault. So each candidate will get an opening statement. Thank you. 2 minutes.
Hey, well, thank you, Julianne. I thank you for agreeing to moderate, and thank you to Jason for hosting the event. Patrick, congratulations to you on your new role. I'm excited to have you there for the next 9 months. We have an amazing amount that we can do together, you and I. And my message to you tonight is, as we sit here right now, you and I have never been more powerful as United States citizens. We've never had more influence on that process that goes on in Washington than we do right now. And I will tell you that's good news, because this has been a community of problem solvers. It's less important for us to figure out who to blame for it, and more important for us to figure out how we can play a role in fixing it. That has been the reputation I have tried to develop in Congress with your voting card since you first lent it to me in 2011. I'm incredibly proud of what we have done together. And it will come as no surprise to you to know that the last 12 or 13 months have been much easier to get things done than those previous 6 years. The entire success of conservative politics, the entire success of the Republican Party hinges on us being able to look each other in the eye and say, we're making a difference today that's going to make tomorrow better than yesterday was. That's the standard I use when I wake up every day with your voting card on Capitol Hill. Did we make a difference together today? I hope you can feel the difference that we're making together. I hope your family feels the difference that we're making together. And I am incredibly pleased to be here with you tonight and talk to you about where we have come from and where we can still go together. Thank you very much, Julianne.
Thank you, Congressman Woodall. Mr. Hazel.
Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Shane Hazel. I'm running for U.S. Congress here in Georgia 7th, obviously. I grew up here, and I'd like to thank you all for coming out to be a part of this process. Thank you to the Forsyth County GOP. Rob, thank you for coming out tonight and being part of this. Thank you, guys, is not enough, because the Georgia 7th is my home. I have lived here almost my entire life. I went to Brookwood High School, graduated in 1998. Shortly after 9/11, I joined the United States Marine Corps, where I was fortunate enough to do two deployments with 1st Force Reconnaissance Company, fought through the battles of Najaf and Fallujah, a lot of things I saw that I don't want anybody to ever see here in America. When I got done, I moved back here to Forsyth County. I graduated from UGA in International Affairs. And this is where I met my beautiful wife, Meredith, and we had our 3 children, and we started a family here. Why am I running for U.S. Congress? Because for the last 8 years, we have been told, give us a House, give us a Senate, and give us the presidency. And what have we done? Because it's not all good news. I am sick to death of career politicians who don't hold town hall meetings in person. I am sick to death the fact that we are still funding things like gun control, Planned Parenthood to the tune of $500 million. I am sick to death of sanctuary cities, domestic spying. I am sick to death that we are still funding Obamacare. I am sick to death that they are taking the lives of my brothers and sisters in service and as veterans flippantly. And I am sick to death for the 21 trillion other reasons that they have compromised my children's future. I look forward to earning your vote May 22nd. And fighting the establishment in D.C. Because with you, we can bring the Constitution back and we can restore this republic. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel. I'll go back to the first question that I asked before. Recent public shootings have opened back up the debate on gun control. What measures from the federal government, if any, do you support to improve school safety? And how do you balance this with protecting Second Amendment rights? Congressman Woodall.
Julianne, I think your question hits at exactly what the problem is that we're having addressing this issue in a way that brings folks together. Some folks describe this as a gun control issue. Some folks describe this as a school safety issue. I would tell you it is only a school safety issue. This is not a problem of old gray-haired men like me walking into our schools. This is a problem of young people hurting young people. What's happening culturally that's true? Now, what have we done on the federal government level? We focused on the database that's supposed to prevent bad actors from getting guns. Had that worked properly, we wouldn't have had Parkland play out the way Parkland had worked, nor Texas play out the way Texas played out. And we funded the COPS grant program, which for those communities that have been caught behind the eight ball, Forsyth has not, Gwinnett has not, but provides those dollars that folks need immediately to be able to make those changes that then those localities and counties will pay for long term.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
Yeah, laws don't stop crimes. Men with guns stop crimes. You can take it from a guy who's voted for Fix Nix in H.R. 38, which puts veterans to the tune of 35,000 veterans a year, or 200 since 2010, 200,000 veterans on lists without due process. That is just not what we do here in America. You have an inalienable, God-given right to own a firearm, period. And what we need to do is arm our schools. They are soft targets, they are target-rich environments. Now, when I talk about H.R. 4660, Mr. Woodall voted for it. That was the Obama anti-gun agenda that put veterans and senior citizens that have received Social Security on lists without due process as well. What we need to do is reinstate the Constitution and get the federal government out of it. Shall not be infringed means shall not be infringed in any way, shape, or form. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Woodall, your name was invoked.
Thank you, Julianne. I didn't know the bill by bill number, but by context, I think the bill that he's talking about is the bill that the NRA supported to make the NICS, the Violent Crime Database, work the way it's supposed to work. If you don't want a background check for gun purchases, repeal the law that requires a background check for gun purchases. But if we're going to have a background check, it ought to work properly. That's what this money did. That's why the NRA supported it. That's why lifetime NRA members voted yes. That's why I supported it as well. It's not enough to pay platitudes to the real fears that families have. And dadgummit, it's my fault as your federal congressman. If I have a federal plan that's not working properly, I need to repeal it or make it do what I promised you it would do. I chose the latter, and I'm proud of it.
Thank you. The next question, we will start with Mr. Hazel. State legislators and Governor Deal have expressed reservations about President Trump's plan to allow offshore drilling off of the Georgia coast. Do you support offshore drilling off of our coast? And if so, how do we ensure protection for wildlife and our coastal waters and beaches?
Well, it definitely isn't the, sorry about that. Well, it definitely isn't the department that handles our environmental issues at the federal level. Obviously, a couple years ago, we saw them dump tons of raw sewage into the Colorado River. What we need to do is control our own state and get the federal government out of it. We need more control here at home, less government regulation, because as we know, through this omnibus bill that spends billions of dollars inside of the environment here in Georgia, it puts regulations that we as Georgians don't necessarily agree with. Do we need to drill for energy? Absolutely. Is there something that we need to protect the environment? Yeah. As a hunter, I'm a conservationist. What we need to do is take control of our own land per Article 1, Section 8, Clause 17, I believe. The only federal control of our state they should have is forts, ports, and magazines at our discretion. And so I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. Congressman Woodall.
Well, we're talking about offshore waters here, and I suspect if I look around the room, I'll find folks who've been supporting offshore drilling around the United States of America for decades. President Obama was working hard to prevent America from harvesting its energy resources, and we have consistently said all of the above. Let's do it all. Now, my job is to make sure the federal government's not standing in our way to run this state the way we see fit. I understand why Governor Deal would have those concerns, Julianne. In fact, every governor of coastal states does have that concern. But it strikes me as a bit hypocritical to continue to vote year after year to open up the Gulf Coast along Florida's, Alabama, and Mississippi shores, and now to say, oh no, but those Georgia waters are off limits because our shore is special. Our shore is special. And my commitment to you is, we're not going to do anything from Washington, D.C. that gets in the way of our self-determination. The only thing that's happened in Washington is we now have permission to determine for ourselves what should happen far offshore.
Thank you. We'll go back to Congressman Woodall. What is your position on the alleged Russian interference with the 2016 election? And do you support the continuation of the Mueller investigation?
Julianne, I want to put those again in two completely different categories. I'm 100% opposed to Russian interference in our elections, the past one or the next one. This bill that we passed last week has money in for election integrity in a bipartisan, common sense way. It matters whether or not we can keep the Russians out of our system. It's not just Facebook posts we're talking about this cycle. It's getting into the voting machines where the tech count is being tabulated. That's completely different as a uniting issue than where the Mueller investigation has been going. Now, I support getting to the bottom so that folks don't have any questions at all about who did what to whom and when did they do it. It offends me the way the president has been maligned for what folks have shown absolutely no proof of whatsoever. We've had the best lawyers in the business trying to catch him on it, and they failed. We finished our investigation in the House. Julianne terminated it with no finding of wrongdoing, and it's coming time for Mr. Mueller to do the same.
Thank you. Mr. Hazel.
Well, I think it's strange in a world where we spend $700 billion a year on defense that Russians could actually hack our election system. Collusion, well, like they talk about, is not a crime in the first place, and so it should be dismissed, and Mueller should probably be terminated at the president's discretion. He is the boss, indeed. But when we flippantly use that type of money in offense and not defense, and we do a whole lot of meddling in places like the Middle East and other parts of the world, it should be no surprise to us, because our CIA, our State Department, our DIA, the NSA, and a whole bunch of other agencies with alphabet soup, they tend to meddle in these people's business, and so we should not be surprised when they try to meddle with ours. What we need to do is strengthen our cybersecurity first and foremost with that. The fact that we still have huge gaps in that, and I understand that because I still have a top secret clearance, that is one of the places we should be pouring that into, and we shouldn't be going off and spending a whole bunch of money overseas. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll go back to you, Mr. Hazel. President Trump has imposed new tariffs of 25% on steel imports and import taxes of 10% on aluminum. Do you support targeted tariffs such as these?
I understand where the president's coming from. He is trying to level the playing field, so to speak. And as a businessman who knows construction and he understands how we are going to build our ships, I get where he's coming from. For a long time, the U.S. worker has been treated unfairly by the likes of NAFTA. What's great about what President Trump has done is he's walked away from deals like TPP that have saved us billions. He's walked away from the Paris Accords, which had no teeth whatsoever to speak of. And what we need to do is start to work to remove government so that we get free trade a chance, where people can trade through consent, where they improve the human condition, prices obviously come down, and the products and services go up at that point.
Congressman Woodall.
Hey, Julianne, what I have found fascinating about this president, you all must have seen it too over the last 13 months, is the way he gets everybody ginned up with the first words that comes out of his mouth. And everybody begins to panic. And suddenly the negotiating table begins to fill up with people, and suddenly people's hard and fast positions begin to melt a little bit, and suddenly we end up in a much better place than we were when we started. I've been fascinated by it on the world stage, and we've seen it time and time again. President started out by saying it's going to be a tariff across the board. Then he said, no, we're going to exempt NAFTA countries because we have agreements with them, so we're going to exempt them. Then he said, no, we're going to exempt folks that we negotiate deals one country at a time with. We'll exempt them. And then we started seeing countries show up one at a time to try to make their deal better. I'm a free trader. But free trade has to also be fair trade. And the only way to get fair trade out of somebody who doesn't want to provide it is to negotiate for it. I applaud the president for what he's doing and the steps that he has made to make that possible.
Thank you. Congressman Woodall, what should Congress do to ensure they maintain integrity within the U.S. intelligence agencies?
You know, oversight over the intelligence agencies is one of the hardest things that we do. If you've been to the Capitol, you've been through the Capitol Visitor Center, the Intelligence Committee is three floors underground there behind a 2-foot steel door. Doing oversight over the Intelligence Committee for rank and file members of Congress is incredibly difficult to do. The most important thing we have to do is make sure we have an Intelligence Committee chairman that we can trust and have confidence in. And I'll tell you, Devin Nunes has done that for me. If you've been following Devin and the way he's worked that committee, he's been doing an amazing job. For me, as your congressman, with your voting card, that means I'm going out to NSA to visit with folks one-on-one. It means I'm going into CIA stations to visit with folks one-on-one. There's a very tight communication between what they call the big four on the intelligence committees for the largest of the programs. I get to go out and visit with the rank and file members of these agencies one-on-one, get the real story from men and women who know, and it matters.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
Once upon a time, when people sat before Congress and testified, we actually saw results. We saw justice. With Jeff Sessions at the helm, we have not seen that. We need oversight into our intelligence agencies that's real and it's accountable. Because if nobody pays and the Congress just investigates itself and investigates the government, back in history, I believe King Henry did the same thing when he shot his brother in the face with an arrow. Don't worry about it, people, we'll investigate ourselves. There has to be justice. What we have seen right now through our Congress, they'll question them all day long, and people who will commit perjury on the stand will walk free. People that target you through the IRS and everything else out there as conservatives walk free. Nobody pays, and I'm afraid that Congress, the larger body, part of the establishment, is to blame for it.
Congressman Woodall, I'm going to allow a rebuttal.
Thank you, Julianne. This is what we do as Republicans. If anybody has any questions about Jeff Sessions' integrity, I want you to come and see me. Or visit any number of your folks who know him at a personal level in Alabama or in the United States Senate. His integrity is beyond reproach. And for us to decide that we finally have a president in the White House who agrees with us, we finally have a cabinet that agrees with us, and the first time things don't go our way, we're going to start throwing out cabinet members because they didn't agree with us, that's not the way to build the nation that you and I both want to build. Jeff Sessions is doing the best he can with the hand that he has been dealt. Whether you want to take it from me, whether you want to take it from Trey Gowdy, whether you want to take it from President Trump, we're doing the best we can to bring to light things that are incredibly sensitive, and rather than rushing to judgment, you're seeing things brought together one line item at a time, exactly the way you and I would want them to do, and I hope it makes you proud.
Mr. Hazel, what is the most serious issue facing American healthcare, and how would you fix it?
Most serious issue facing American healthcare. Well, it's probably the same thing that's facing our time. It's a government crisis. Where the government interjects itself, we see more cost and less service. Being a veteran, I see it firsthand. Veterans, we are pandered to left and right by people like Mr. Woodall, who send out flyers paid with your tax money about veterans. When in fact, the VA can't be saved. We are the product of a single-payer system where we wait in line, we receive terrible service when we get there, and sometimes they just throw pills at us. What we need to do is get government out of healthcare, period, once and for all, and let states choose for themselves. If California wants to be single-payer, by all means, but the rest of us need a free market, and the Congress needs to free us up. On top of that, the spending. What we spend and what they'll tell you we spend in Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, is completely out of line with what they've told us for the past 8 years.
Thank you. Mr. Woodall.
Julianne, you can read any of the actuaries' reports if you want the numbers. There's no serious person who would tell you that those actuarial reports have been pushed one way or the other by any party in particular. It's just the math and the accounting, and there's some frightening numbers in there. I would encourage you to read that. The challenge we have with where the federal government is involved in healthcare, and even in third-party payer systems in private ways, is folks don't have skin in the game any longer. If you don't have skin in the game as a consumer, you can't control anything. Imagine going to Walmart if there were no prices on anything to try to figure out your grocery list. Would you make different decisions than you do today? Of course you would. The question is, how can we get more consumer participation? And anybody who wants a single-payer plan, it's easy to do. We've always passed that law. breathing life back into a competitive healthcare system, a free market system, that's a once-in-a-generation opportunity. And we need all hands on deck to make sure we get that done.
Mr. Hazel, I'm going to allow a rebuttal.
Yeah, the fact that we still have Obamacare on the books with Republicans at the helm after 8 years, no proper prior planning, as we used to say in the Marine Corps, that prevents piss-poor performance where I come from. The fact that we don't have a plan, the fact that we still have Obamacare, the fact that they changed the narrative from full repeal and they took 72 show votes, and when it was time to actually go out and play ball, they offered up what? The individual mandate? It's absurd. It's an affront to the American people. Mr. Woodall has been part of that, and it's got to stop. I'm telling you right now, I will never spend money, and I will never vote outside the Constitution. That is not a constitutionally delegated authority of the Congress to do anything with health care. It is a power reserved to the people and the states. Thank you.
Mr. Woodall, can the federal budget be balanced without raising taxes, and if so, how?
The federal budget cannot be balanced if we refuse to deal with revenues ever. We'll have a chance to talk about this when the Highway Trust Fund gets reauthorized. The Highway Trust Fund is a user fee based system. If we don't want more roads, we don't need more roads. If we want more roads, we should be willing to pay for more roads. The most dangerous thing happening in conservative politics today is folks who are telling us that we can get a free lunch. We cannot. This was not a $1.5 trillion tax cut. It was a $1.5 trillion tax cut today that we're all gonna have to pay back in the future. Now it's gonna be good, the economy is gonna be higher, things are going to be better. It was good economics. But it is irresponsible of us to send folks to Congress or any level of government where the message is, I want more stuff, but I'm not the one who's willing to pay for it, tax him. We're either in it together or we're not. This is as good an example of fiscal stewardship in this county as we have anywhere in the country.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
Good stewardship starts with spending our money wisely, not spending it in 17 hours, 2,000 plus pages, and $1.3 trillion, who my opponent voted for. We have a money issue in this country. In this time, we audit the Fed. We had, in the turn of the century, in 1900, 5 silver quarters made out of silver. That was $1.25, and that was minimum wage. Today, those 5 real silver quarters that don't exist anymore, those are worth $15 an hour. What we could do is audit the Fed and the Federal Transparency Act of 2017, I would sign on to immediately. My opponent has not. There are over 100 representatives that have. Let that sink in for a second. We are the party of limited government and responsibility, period. And when we vote otherwise, we're not Republicans. When we vote for omnibus bill after omnibus bill and appropriations bill with no accountability, we've got to send a message to DC.
Thank you, Mr. Woodall, a rebuttal?
Julianne, the reason he sees the world through that lens is because he's not in the thick of it. This process didn't start last week. The House passed all the appropriations bills line by line by line last September. We've been working on this for 6 months to get today. Omnibus bills are not the right way to do business, and Senator Perdue and I have been placed on a 16-member committee to solve that. I'm excited about what we're going to be able to do. But lest folks forget, it was an omnibus bill that we passed that protected Forsyth and Gwinnett County's water from Alabama just 2 years ago. The omnibus bill is just another word for we did it all at one time, putting together those individual things we've done along the way. The Senate process is broken. Please don't ask me to defend that. But it is voting no on everything that I would tell you cost us the opportunity to repeal Obamacare and cost us the opportunity for the largest mandatory spending reform in history, and I hope we'll get a chance to talk about that.
Thank you. Mr.
Hayes? I get a rebuttal, correct?
Well, usually it's just a rebuttal if you invoke the other person.
He did. He said, I'm not in the thick.
Go ahead.
Correct?
Sure. Go ahead.
Great. 79 to $70.9 billion to take over the education system centrally, central planning for Common Core. $51 million in international family planning and reproductive health, $10 million for environmental UN programs, $20 million in Middle East scholarships, $50 million for Planned Parenthood. Unbelievable to sit here and have the gall to tell all these people it's sunshine and rainbows, and then it's been going on since last September. 17, you can see it boils my blood. It is one of those things where they spend our kids' futures into oblivion, and they don't blink about telling you how good it is. And you're not a Jedi. You're not going to sit here and say these aren't the appropriations and funding you're looking for. It's absolutely insane. Ladies and gentlemen, I will never ever spend one red cent on Planned Parenthood, period, along with all the other unconstitutional programs that are up there. I've signed and rejected the debt, and I'm told I need to stop now, so I will, but keep going.
Okay, thank you. So back to Mr. Hazel, do you believe that congressmen should have term limits, and if so, why, and if not, why not?
I've already invoked and self-imposed 8 years on myself. I will be leaving and coming back to spend time with my family. This is not something that I think that I ever even imagined doing, and it's going to take a heck of a lot more time away from my prized possession, which is my family. Yes, I will be coming home. I will encourage others to self-impose term limits, and we will lead by example not only there, but we will not take the congressional pension, and we will not take the congressional health care, unlike my opponent. Because when you do that, what you're doing is saying, we have a political class that's not the same as your average citizen. That's also got to stop. We all live in America, and equal justice for all was one of those things that we used to say in school every morning. I will work to fight for term limits across the board, and I will do it by leadership. Thank you.
Thank you. Congressman Woodall?
Julianne, my constitution tells me we already have term limits. They're called elections. They happen every 2 years, and if elections are broken, let's fix elections. But I don't think we need a constitutional amendment to tell me that I can't send back to the United States Senate a senator that I'm proud of. So I reject the notion that self-governance is broken and elections are broken in a way that require a constitutional amendment to fix it. I don't know where to begin, Julianne, with the misinformation that gets put out, but I want to share it with you all. If you elect a new congressman to this district, he's going to get the exact same pension that the guy who mows the lawn at the U.S. Department of Agriculture gets in downtown Atlanta. If you elect a new congressman to this district, he's not going to get the health care plan that gardener gets. The gardener's going to get a better plan. He's going to go on Obamacare because that's the only plan that's available to the United States Congress. Please don't buy into the same things that my mother buys into from time to time and emails me about. Rob, I raised you better than that. These things are not true, and repeating them only undermines our conservative cause.
Mr. Hazel?
Yeah, so at a meeting, you look it up on YouTube. He said, I take it because it's free. You can't expect people not to take things that are free. So yeah, it's a little different in misinformation. All right, more sunshine and rainbows, people. It is incumbent upon us to live our lives in line with you. And that is, I don't know how else to say it. It is absolutely repugnant to sit there and say, they don't. They obviously do. There's a Walter Reed Center on the top floor that takes care of everybody. The bottom floors are reserved for veterans, and they definitely receive much better care. And Obamacare is not what I'm going to be going after. I'm going to go out to the same marketplace that you guys have to deal with.
Okay, Mr. Woodall?
We can exist in the world of reality or we cannot. And I will tell you that I want you to think back to a year ago today, a year ago in March. We were on the verge of passing the repeal of Obamacare. We were on the verge of passing the largest mandatory spending change in the history of this country in block granting Medicaid. And vote no conservatives decided it wasn't good enough, and they balked. It took us 2.5 months to get it done. We finally did get it done. How many votes did that bill fail by in the United States Senate? One. You tell me, if instead of kicking the president in the shins on our primary agenda, first out of the gate, we'd come together and said, no, it's not perfect, but it's better than doing nothing, I'm in, would it have been worth one more vote in the United States Senate? You know what momentum does in politics. That's what keeps me up at night. Not the ridiculous narratives that come from folks who aren't studying the material, but the truth that we had a chance to make a difference. and we let perfection keep us from it.
Thank you. Mr. Woodall, are there any federal departments you would support consolidating or eliminating?
I wouldn't start with the VA. I've made too many promises to veterans. The country has made too many promises to veterans, and it's a generational issue. My younger veterans would rather use the Veterans Choice Program that we created and opt out of the VA. But many of my older veterans say, Rob, the VA is the only group that understands me. Now, I want them to work better. I want them to be more efficient, but they're the only folks who understand me. There's not a federal department that we have that we've got to keep. There's not a one that we've got to keep. We can turn the Pentagon into a triangle. America will live to fight another day. The question is, how are we achieving those goals? The Department of Agriculture, led by our former Governor Perdue, is running better today than it was 14 months ago. I've reduced fewer departments of the parts of the Department of Agriculture today because of who is there in control. I think we've got to use all the levers we have while we have a president who's willing to use them wisely and continue the attrition of federal government employees as President Trump has made part of our collective mission.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
Yeah, absolutely. I would abolish the VA because I'm a veteran. I've been in the system. I know how it works. I speak to veterans all the time and know how it works. You abolish the VA, you give every veteran an Amex card, and the DoD picks up the cost of war, which are veterans, because we're all different. Some of us are gonna handle PTSD differently, some of us are gonna handle our wounds differently, and we need the choice to go where we want, because right now, when we walk in there, we're told after a couple months, you have an appointment, maybe you can come in. We don't have the technology to upload anything that you have in terms of, you know, images and anything else, and then, after taking some blood work, maybe you had some Chick-fil-A beforehand, your blood looks like gravy. Instead of actually having a conversation with you about your diet, they'll throw opioids and cholesterol medicine at you before you even know what happened. It's absolutely ridiculous and absurd. I'd cut the VA, I'd cut the Department of Education, I would cut the IRS, abolish the IRS and stop state-sponsored terrorism right now because it's targeted groups like you. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Hazel, what would your top legislative priorities be in the next Congress?
Ladies and gentlemen, it's no secret that veterans, service members are nearest and dearest to me. Article 1, Section 8 gave us the power of war in Congress. We have not declared war since World War II, and yet we spend almost $1 trillion on it every year without mission. And this is what broke my back to get into this race, because when I called Congressman Woodall's office, couple years ago, and I said, you guys just spent $700 billion. What's the mission? That's exactly what I heard. Taking the lives of our men and women flippantly and sending them overseas into countries where we have not declared war, putting boots on the ground, destroying families, souls, lives. Those are my brothers that have got 10 plus deployments down line. That is unforgivable. And the fact that the Congress hasn't stood up and made a peep but continues to fund it because we have to have defense as a lie. We have been on offense. What we should do is pull our men and women back. We should pull them into a security posture and increase technology and defense here at home, not abroad.
Thank you. Mr. Woodall.
Julianne, those deployment decisions, as everyone in this room knows, fall under Article 2, not Article 1. It is absolutely true that we have not worked together as a nation to make sure that everybody has the same amount of skin in the game. When you talk about what the revenue components of a future a bill could be, I think we've got to talk about how it is we fund that overseas mission. If you don't have a son or a daughter, a mom or a dad involved in the war effort today, it's not at the top of your list. It's certainly not on the front page of the paper. It's not anywhere to be found in Section A. And if we don't have skin in the game, just like in healthcare we make bad decisions, in foreign affairs we make bad decisions too. But I've got a brand new president on a very dangerous world stage. And careless talk in the middle of a debate is a freebie. But undermining the president in front of America's enemies is not. And I'm not going to be a part of it.
Mr. Hazel, a rebuttal?
Yeah, I'll rebut, and I'll stand up to the president, too. Because what we should be talking about is peace. Peace, was a virtue and a principle that our framers held dear. And we have been in battle for 17 plus years, and not a peep out of this office or a ton of other offices up there in DC. It is time to stand up and fight. We can't just go along to get along. Yes, is North Korea an irrational actor? Sure. Is Iran an irrational actor? But guess what? Where goods and services cross boundaries, armies and tanks don't. And the people that pay are the grunts and the special forces, my brothers. That's got to change. Because it's not on the headline news anymore, don't forget about it, because they haven't forgot about it. And when they say they won't make the fight, I believe them. He won't make the fight. He won't have that discussion. I'm not going up there to make friends, people. I am going up there on a mission to restore the Constitution and this republic.
Thank you. Mr. Woodall, would you like to rebut?
I would, Julianne. If you elect Shane King for a day, he can do everything that he's promised you. The Constitution will be out the window, but he could do it. We vote time and time again to control U.S. foreign policy, and we don't have the votes to win. Folks, we have a Republican majority. We don't have a conservative majority on Capitol Hill. And to decide that folks are going to do nothing because they can only do a little is a mistake, a fatal mistake. We have an opportunity with this White House to work together. I'm not surrendering my oversight responsibilities of the White House, and you can see that in the investigations going on Capitol Hill. But on the international stage, where the Congress does not have a large constitutional role, I tell you that I didn't want to go out and undermine my president when he was a Democrat, and I most certainly don't want to undermine my president with our enemies when he is a Republican. We are Americans first, and foreign affairs is the place we show that to the world.
Thank you. Mr. Woodall, what will you do in the next Congress to address illegal immigration?
Yeah, I wouldn't wait till the next Congress, Julianne. I think we can do it right now, and candidly, we can do this in partnership together. Folks have forgotten how to say yes. It's all fight, 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 fight. You're wrong, I'm right. Folks have forgotten how to take yes for an answer. The president offered dreamers an answer. He said, listen, all I want to do is make sure another generation doesn't get trapped in this same space. So let's focus on border security. And I want to make sure that we have an immigration policy that promotes employment. So let's focus on skills-based immigration. And laws are laws, so we do need interior enforcement. But beyond that, let's put this behind us forever. I now have dreamers coming into my office saying, Rob, I need you to support the Trump immigration plan. What we can't do is let the left off for saying we don't have a plan and that we have an opportunity. They want this as a political issue instead of a way to move the country forward. You can't move immigration reform forward without doing border security, because you just trap another family in that same space tomorrow. But the president has offered a negotiated bargain. Wouldn't have been the one I proposed, but I support him, and I believe we can get it done this year.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
So when you guys say you support him, does that mean you spend $1.3 trillion and there's very little set aside for a border wall? We still fund sanctuary cities that are out in California? Because that's what we just did. $1.3 trillion we're still spending out in California and giving grants and everything else, and we have no border security. You do a couple things. Shut off the welfare magnet, period. No illegals get welfare from the United States. That'll start pushing them back right there. We can bring our troops home, secure the southern border real quick, and we can give them all a raise so that they can compete with those wages out there on the free market. There's a real easy fix to our border security. Turn off the welfare, secure the border with our veterans and our military, and let it be gone. We've just gotten ridiculous, I guess, in passing an omnibus bill with all of this in it. We spent, 17 hours is what you guys passed it in? 17 hours, 2,000 pages, at one page per minute. It would take 37 hours to read it. And that's what they did.
Thank you, Mr. Woodall.
Julianne, as anybody who's read the bill knows, there are more miles of wall in that omnibus bill than President Trump asked for this year. We plussed that up. We plussed up the number of detention beds in that bill. And President Trump, as you saw if you follow his Twitter feed, almost vetoed the bill because he wanted to solve the DACA issue in this bill too, and the Democrats said no, they wouldn't sign off on it because they wanted to keep it as a political issue. They don't believe the nonsense that immigration is only a net negative. I'm going to tell you, This has always been a country that has attracted people because of freedom and opportunity. It's not welfare that brings most people here. It's the desire to build a better life for their family through hard work. I'm just going to tell you, be flippant if you would like. I represent in this district, and Shane would too, 27% of this district is first-generation American families legally. And they came here because they believe in what we believe in, faith, family, freedom, education, opportunity. I don't denigrate them. I applaud them. I'm glad they're here.
Illegal immigration. You want to play with words, that's fine. They all know it. They laughed. I mean, good. Thank you. I mean, it is. It's laughable at this point. It's laughable when they come down here and they tell us, oh, everything's great. Here's some good news. Let me pull out my prop constitution because I'm not going to abide by it. Things like privacy that is not in your constitution either. Listen, there are real fixes. There's a real fight that needs to happen. I'm telling you, on this stage, I'm pretty sure most of you understand who's going to make the fight.
Thank you. So, Mr. Woodall, infrastructure is one of the major responsibilities of government. In a growing and fast-paced economy like Metro Atlanta, our infrastructure has had a very difficult time keeping up with growth. On March 14th, President Trump sent five cabinet secretaries to go before the Senate Committee on Commerce. Commerce, Science, and Transportation, for the purpose of gaining bipartisan support for the President's $1.5 trillion infrastructure plan to repair roads, bridges, ports, and airports. Many doubt it will ever see a vote. Do you support this plan? And can you explain how it will benefit Georgia and work in cooperation with states? And how can it be paid for?
We're in the best place to benefit, Julianne, because we have a track record of success and stewardship. Whether you talk about Forsyth County and the bonding initiative out on 400 that was 12 months from a vote to groundbreaking and 12 months from groundbreaking to opening up a lane, or whether you talk about the work that went on down the 85 bridge rebuild. The entire nation was watching that effort, and Georgia developed a reputation for being serious about being a stewardship of those funds. So anything that provides more infrastructure funding at the federal level, Julianne, we will be the beneficiaries of here in Georgia. But don't give us not enough credit for what we've been doing to fund ourselves here in Georgia, and that's the real challenge in President Trump's plan. A lot of folks want to take that money and spend it on states that have done nothing to help themselves, folks who are in so-called crisis spaces. Georgia raised its taxes $1 billion a year so we could begin to move forward ourselves. We front-loaded all the Savannah Port funding, paying for it ourselves, so we'd be ready when the federal money came. Biggest job that I have is making sure it goes to folks who have been good stewards, not those who have frittered their opportunities away.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
What our job is to keep Article 6, Section 3, our oath of office, in check, and that is to the Constitution and the Constitution only. There is no space in there for most of the things that they spend money on. And think about this. Our government pulls in a little over $3.5 trillion a year. You divide that by 435 congressmen up there, that is $9 billion a piece that they're told to spend responsibly. That is the farce that is our federal government. In terms of our roads and our infrastructure, Mr. Woodall sits on the committee. Where is it at? We have bridges collapsing. We have no accountability still from the U.S. Congress, and it'll continue and continue. But to spend each one of them $9 billion a piece, that is like telling a Mark Zuckerberg, go out and spend your entire life fortune and do it responsibly. That was why the founders wanted the money left in the states in the first place. What we need to do is abolish the IRS, which we didn't hear a word about during the last tax overhaul from apparently the champion.
Mr. Reynolds.
Julianne, it's tough to know where to begin. Those math numbers aren't anywhere close to right. Georgia's entire take from the FAST Act, which is our transportation funding bill, was about $6 billion. And I'll tell you, if you want good stewardship, we've got a room full of conservatives here. We gave the private sector a giant bonus when they finished the I-85 rebuild on time or ahead of time and under budget. Anybody mad about that big bonus that those guys got? Anybody think that that's a problem? Folks, we incentivized good behavior and we got good behavior. And we're now a model for the rest of the country. I'm not at all surprised about some of the shenanigans that went on in the Obama Transportation Department, but Secretary Chow is second to none in terms of being a talented leader. She's spending more time in Georgia than almost any other state in the nation. And we can do woe is me if we'd like, but our opportunity is now to make a difference. We have, and we will continue to. I'm optimistic about tomorrow, Julianne.
Hazel, would you like to rebut?
When you continue to spend the way they do, erratically, irresponsibly, negligently, you're going to continue to get the same thing over and over and over. It's all sunshine and rainbows here. Don't worry about it. Nothing to see. Move along, citizen. The $3.5 trillion, if we're listening, is what the U.S. government pulls in every year. With $3.5 trillion, and we spend probably about $4 trillion of that, because let's not let our kids have a future. Let's put them in debt. That money could pave the roads in Georgia and every other state in the nation multiple times over, but it's squandered for special interests so that they don't make people mad through omnibus bills and appropriations bills, so they come back to their district and get reelected and start the whole vicious cycle over and over again.
Mr. Hazel, what would your plans be to stop the federal government from continuing to encroach upon states' rights?
Make a fight. For God's sakes, nullification, standing up, education, it takes a backbone. It doesn't take an act of Congress. We need to teach locally. That's why I teach the Constitution here. That's why I teach it to groups so that they can empower their own legislatures, their own citizens, their own councilmen, so that they can stand up. Because when's the last time we had a governor that sat there and said, no, federal government, you will not come in the state? The Attorney General, the Secretary of State, when is the last time they push back? They have a small and defined box that they're supposed to be in. And then our governor, our citizens here, we should be holding them accountable. That's what we should be doing to push them back. They're not gonna ever limit themselves. Governments just don't do that. Governments grow overnight, and they will take as much lead as you'll give them. What we have to do is cut them off, and that's gonna take somebody who's gonna go up there and fight them. It's not gonna be somebody that approves omnibus bills and appropriations bills every time they come across their desk, and then, on top of that, raise the debt ceiling so that we can keep doing it.
Thank you, Mr. Woodall.
Julianne, I confess I've forgotten what the question was.
What will you do to stop the federal government's continued encroachment upon states' rights?
You can say that no one puts up a fight and states never push back and we just roll over, but that's not giving the citizens of Georgia enough credit. That Obamacare plan was on its way to nationalizing every ounce of health care we have in this country, and citizens like those of us in Georgia stood up and said no, and the governor sued and the attorney general sued, and we won. The underpinning of Obamacare was putting everybody on the expanded Medicaid program. States like Georgia said no, and we stopped it. The most challenging thing I have in terms of states' rights are that folks like them sometimes, they don't like them others. I have the lowest NRA score of any Republican in the state of Georgia, because the NRA said, I want to nationalize some gun laws. And I said, no, my reading of the Constitution tells me that's a state-by-state issue. You don't get to encroach in that way. I voted no. Cost me on a scorecard, doesn't matter on a scorecard. I'm going to do what I think is right on our behalf. But I got phone calls from so many states' rights folks here who said, Rob, well, in this case, maybe the Second Amendment should trump the Tenth Amendment. I say no.
So on Obamacare, we won, huh? Is that what you're telling me? Because I'll tell you right now, I have a single-income family, and I went from probably paying about $4,000 to $5,000 a year to now we're up to about $20,000 a year for health care. We didn't win as a population. That's the Georgia 7th District, I can tell you, is in the same boat I am because I talk to my neighbors. We are definitely not winning on health care, especially when they told us they were going to repeal it and not replace it. Let the free market work. Repeal it already, for God's sakes. I mean, these broken promises, this 2018 is gonna be a heck of a year, people, because not only the primaries going on, but then we have the midterms, and the Republicans, because of voting like this, are gonna get shellacked.
Well,
Julianne, I'm not looking for the vote no all the time vote. I'm willing to concede I'm probably not gonna win Shane's vote here tonight. But what I am gonna do is be proud about the work I've done with your voting card for 7 years, and I'm gonna go back and I'm gonna do it again for the next 9 months, and if you give me the honor, I'll do it again for another 2 years. I can tell you, and it will break your heart, line item after line item after line item that we could have gotten done, but we failed because the perfectionist caucus said no. If you want to be right, go be a college professor. If you want to get something done, come to the United States Congress. To denigrate what Governor Deal did and our Attorney General did in pushing back on Medicaid expansion is to fail to acknowledge the biggest success in states' rights that we've had in the last two decades. If it's not good enough, fair enough. But don't deny its existence. It was a step in the right direction, and we should keep pushing, not throw folks under the bus who made the fight.
Thank you. This will be our final general question for both candidates. I think we're doing very well on time. We managed to get through all the questions. Recently, we have seen more left-leaning textbooks, especially in AP classes, in our public schools as a result of federally pushed Common Core. How have you used, or will you use, your office to bring more local control to our school systems in the Southern District?
Well, two answers to that right off the bat, Julianne. Number one, we repealed No Child Left Behind. We were opposed on that repeal effort by folks who said it didn't do enough. Wall Street Journal called it the largest return of power and local control to local school systems in the history of the country. But for some people, it wasn't enough. I voted yes because I wanted to make that positive step in the right direction. I know folks are still concerned about Common Core. The law of the land, as we sit here today, is the federal government can neither punish nor incentivize anyone, anywhere, to adopt Common Core. That's a change in the law. We pushed it. We won. It's the law of the land as we sit here today. I know there are a lot of school systems that are failing, and they worry that they need federal help. I represent an area where school systems are second to none, and I worry the federal government's going to come in and mess up what we've spent so many local hours, so many families, so many teachers, so many administrators trying to build. We'll keep pushing back on that, Julianne, but we've made great progress in the last 4 years.
Thank you. Mr. Hazel?
I wish his rhetoric matched his voting record, because $70.9 billion was spent in the omnibus for the Department of Education. My wife's a teacher. I understand very well the disaster, which is Common Core and federal government overreach, which is not sanctioned through our Constitution. It's not a power. When it came through with Jimmy Carter, it started to grow. It started to centralize power of the federal government in education. And what do we have now? Common Core, even though maybe they repealed it. He voted on S-1177, where every student succeeds, mandatory testing. It's just a dumb little word for Common Core, people. He's funded it over and over and over to the tune of billions of dollars. And then H.R. 899, where Thomas Massey put it forward to the Congress, abolished the Department of Education with one subject, one page, and Mr. Woodall did not sign on to that. I'll tell you right now, funding the Department of Education at the national level is a travesty. We have lower test scores now. We have a worse product in reading and writing, you name it. We've got to stop it.
Julianne, he's invoked Thomas Massey's name twice. I wish Thomas was here to tell you who it is he thinks is a champion for conservative ideals on Capitol Hill, and I promise you he would be sitting right here beside me, because we've worked together time and time again to make a difference. The Every Student Succeeds Act that he belittles is the one that repealed No Child Left Behind. Now, you can have your pick. You can keep No Child Left Behind if you'd like, or you can pass Every Student Succeeds. I choose repeal and pass. What he cites as mandatory testing language that's the same as Common Core is actually a specific repeal of federal mandates of mandatory testing that allows individual jurisdictions to decide for themselves how to evaluate the success of their students. That was one of the bills we used the Congressional Review Act to repeal from the Obama administration regulatory agenda.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
It's all sunshine and rainbows still. Meanwhile, test scores have gone down in our general population. Reading has gone down. Writing has gone down. These cursive. The understanding of civics has gone down, and the understanding of our constitutional republic has obviously hit almost rock bottom. We sit there and say, well, we're not going to fund this. It's not because we don't love kids and we don't love teachers. In fact, the opposite is true. This whole one-size-fits-all for every school district across this nation, we need to be fostering small business entrepreneurial spirit. That's not what we talk about. We talk about the track to college. You've got to go to college so you can get a career, so you can give the government all your money, so they can spend it on ludicrous things like quail being more sexually promiscuous on coke. It's ridiculous. That's what this Bahamas dust does. It's insane. To say we need more of it, I don't know what to do with the people. What I do know, it is not a constitutionally delegated authority of the federal government, and therefore, per my oath, I will not be voting for it.
Thank you. At this time, we're going to move on to the next portion, where each candidate will be asking a question of the opposing candidate. So we will begin with Mr. Hazel. Please ask your question of your choice to Congressman Woodall.
Sure. Congressman Woodall, you rate an F from Conservative Review, The New American. You got a D from Heritage, which will probably drop to an F after they factor in the omnibus bill. Why don't you just run as the Democrat?
I appreciate that question, Shane. Does anybody ever look at that?
I did.
Anybody look
Stop.
At
that? Stop. Hold it. Rob, I've had enough of it.
We're going to remain civil. The congressman doesn't mind answering this question, and we're going to remain civil in this audience, please. Congressman?
If there's any confusion in this audience about whether I'm surrendering your voting card to any scoring organization on Capitol Hill, the answer is no, I am not. It belongs to you. Conservative Review will tell you, if you go and look at their scorecard, that Elizabeth Warren and a guy named Johnny Isaacson are about the same degree of conservatism. Do you buy that?
Yeah.
Do you believe that Conservative Review would tell you that Kamala Harris, likely a Democratic nominee for the presidency, is twice the conservative that Johnny Isaacson is?
Yeah, I'm right. Yeah.
We just have a different idea of what it means to be a public servant. Folks want 100%, or they say vote no. I'm calling 80% a victory, and score me an F all day long, every day. David Perdue's got a D. Who believes that? Folks, we define conservatism, not some for-profit magazine, and it's gonna stay that way as long as I have your voting card.
Okay. Would you like to rebut any of those?
Sure.
Okay. Mr. Woodall?
Julianne, I didn't have this question, but having listened tonight, I understand everything that Shane's gonna vote no against, and he's upset that I voted yes. My question is there anything that I voted no on, and if only you were there, you'd have made it happen?
Is there anything you voted no on that I'd make happen?
Yeah.
Specifically?
You disagree with all of my yes votes. I'm just wondering if you disagree with my no votes as well.
You've done a few things well. I believe when you give people the choice to go and choose their medication in terms of the state's rights and giving families choices, where they have kids with epilepsy, cancer, things like that, I think that's actually a pretty good vote. Outside of that, yeah, I absolutely disagree with most of your voting record.
To be fair, I wasn't asking what you appreciated about my voting record, though I am grateful for that. What I was saying is, clearly you don't like the fact that I support so many items in the president's agenda. I'm looking for something that I opposed that you said, you know what, I finally do think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
We should have gotten
Every time you support the United States Constitution, per your oath, I agree with you. And that is what we should be looking for, our congressmen and women who vote with the Constitution. It's not even partisan. It's just a document that kept our government on track and out of our lives. Whenever he votes yes with that, I'm absolutely fine with that, Congressman. I am, and I pray that you do it more and more often and you start to set a trend, because what we see now is absolutely insanity, and it's not sunshine and rainbows. We've got to make a correction. We've got to have somebody there that's gonna make that fight for the entire 100%, not just 80.
And Mr. Woodall, I will ask you what I ask Mr. Hazel. Would you like to rebut?
No, thank you, Julie.
All right, thank you. At this time, we'll move into closing statements, and we'll begin with Mr. Woodall.
Well, I got to begin with you, and now I'm getting to end with you. I appreciate you coming out tonight. I'm proud of what we've done together for 7 years. I'm thrilled about this campaign that we're going to have. We get to choose who we are as Republicans. The day in and day out, We show up together and we're able to make a difference. We're able to make a difference when it comes to tax reform. And that bill is different and better because you and I are involved. We're able to make a difference when it comes to spending. And yes, we are spending less because you and I are involved. We're able to make a difference with our neighbors. It's been over 1,300 pieces of casework we've had a chance to work on together for our neighbors who are grappling with the federal government. Just this cycle, 50,000 pieces of correspondence that we've traded back and forth as we've worked to try to make things better. But folks, I'll tell you, this is just the sideshow for all Republicans across the country this primary season. The fight comes in November. And if you tell me that we're going to run on how angry we are instead of the lowest unemployment in 50 years, the highest business optimism in two decades, the lowest number of layoffs in 50 years, the highest rate of school completion education that we've seen, folks, we are getting it done together. This fight is going to be over folks who aren't sure whether America should look more like Elizabeth Warren or Donald Trump. We've got a chance to tell our story of success as we have experienced it here locally and as we've delivered it in Washington, D.C. I'm asking you for your support and for your vote, and I thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you. Mr. Hazel.
Thank you again, everybody, for coming out and listening to this. I really do appreciate it. Ladies and gentlemen, the arbitrary federal government that we have now is a crisis of our time. I believe the constitutional government is the fix, and you've got to have a fighter for that. I swore that oath to uphold the Constitution, and that means more now than it ever has. We have got to get back to some sanity and lead by example. That's why I'm leaving after 8 years no matter what. That's why I will not be taking the health care that's provided by our government at that level, and I will not be taking the pension plan either. I look forward to earning your vote May 22nd. I believe we need a principled, proven fighter in D.C. to represent the Georgia 7th District, which is my home. I appreciate you guys coming out. Thank you for the Republican Party for putting this on. I will see you guys around the Georgia 7th District and everywhere else I find you. Good night.
Thank you everyone for coming. We hope to see you on May 2nd.
Thank you.